missions by attacking more innocent civilians in these villages. Therefore, it was necessary to formally organize these civilians into a proper paramilitary force capable of protecting vulnerable villages. 42,000 able-bodied men were recruited from the villages and given proper training as well as equipment. They played a significant role in protecting their villages from LTT attacks during the course of the humanitarian operation. Alongside the commitment of the president and the political hierarchy to the humanitarian operations, it was equally essential that the government itself have the stability to see the campaign through its conclusion. This was a particular issue for the president and the key political leadership because the then government comprised a coalition that had only a tenuous majority in parliament. If the government had collapsed at any point during the military campaign, all our efforts would have been in vain. The president managed this issue by keeping the party, his party's coalition partners together and persuading opposition figures to support him and consolidate the party's position in parliament. For this reason, the cabinet had to be increased to a historic size, and various portfolios were handed over to notable party members within the coalition. There was a great deal of criticism of this at that time, but it was an absolutely necessary step maintaining the government's stability and a political stability. Even more important than maintaining political stability was generating popular support. By 2005, Sri Lankan population had gone from war to peace and back again. There was a lot of cynicism and war weariness in the public at large. If the government had focused only on the war, it was entirely possible that the people would not have supported the war effort. This is one of the reasons why the government invested so much on welfare efforts, even at time when it could hardly afford to because of the large war budget. A sterling example of the thought given to the well-being of ordinary Sri Lankans was the fertilizer subsidy granted at a time when international prices were skyrocketing. This eased the heavy burden felt by the Sri Lankan farmers and kept food prices affordable to the general population. It should be also not be forgotten that Sri Lanka had been ravaged by the Asian tsunami only 2 years before the military campaign was resumed. There was a lot of rebuilding that had not yet been completed. In addition, a lot of infrastructure development, particularly in power generation and upgrading of the road networks, was necessary to spur economic growth. The president and the government did not ignore these responsibilities. Instead, they skillfully engaged in multifocal governance, where the other critical national requirements were met, while the focus on the military campaign was not in any way reduced. Along with these domestic issues, another key factor underpinning the success of our operations was the management of international pressure by the political leadership. In 1987, the enormously successful Vadamarachi operation had pushed the LTT to the brink of defeat. However, these operations could not be sustained because of the Indian government intervening. The primary problem in 1987 was that the relationship between the two countries had not been managed very effectively. In contrast, from the time of his election, President Rajapaksa went out of his way to keep New Delhi brief about all the new developments taking place in Sri Lanka. He understood that while other countries could mount pressure on us through diplomatic channels or economic means, only the India could influence the military campaign. From very early in the military campaign, the relationship between Sri Lanka and India was managed through maintaining a clear communications line at the very highest level. A special committee was established to engage in constant dialogue. The Sri Lanka side comprised then senior advisor to the President, Basil Rajapaksa, secretary to the President, Mr. Lalit Veerathunga, and myself as the Defense Secretary. The Indian side comprised former National Security Advisor, Mr. M.K. Narayan, the Foreign Secretary, Sri Shivashankar Menon, and then Defense Secretary, Mr. Vijay Singh. This troika had continuous discussions and ensured that whenever any sensitive issues arose, they would be resolved immediately. The government also ensured that our relationship with other important regional allies and other friendly countries were well maintained through usual diplomatic channels and regular dialogue. Ultimately, this able management of critical international relations was another key success factor in the eradication of terrorism. Unfortunately, it has to be noted that influential figures in few countries outside the region were skeptic about the government's decision to reopen a military campaign against the LTT. There was many reasons for this. A key reason was a fundamental misunderstanding about the nature of the LTT and the necessity to eradicate it. I spoke earlier about the numerous atrocities and human rights violations carried out by the LTT. Unfortunately, the LTT also had a great deal of global influence through some elements of the Tamil diaspora, which played a significant role in the electoral politics of certain Western nations. This influence, combined with the skill of the LTT propaganda machine, was strong enough to create a false competing narrative in which the LTT assumed the guise of a liberation army for an oppressed population. This is far from the truth. While it is true that the LTT's first major attack on an army convoy in 1983 sparked riots in the south, during which the Tamil community suffered at the hands of violent mobs, Sri Lanka as a nation grew up very rapidly after that incident and left those dark days far behind. The progress made in national reconciliation and integration since 1983 has been very encouraging. For a long time, even at the height of terrorist activities in the 1990s, when thousands of innocent men and women and children were killed on a yearly basis by the LTT's bomb blast and attacks, there were no more backlashes against the Tamil community. On the contrary, the majority of the Tamil population has lived outside the North and East for many years and comprise an integral part of the Sri Lankan community and the national identity. Colombo in particular is a thriving multi-ethnic hub that boasts a large Tamil population, which has produced many of the nation's leading professionals and businessmen. They led lives of distinction in a supportive multicultural environment devoid of communal tension and have done so for many years. Nevertheless, the LTT's propaganda machine kept flogging the lie that the Tamil community would have no chance to prosper so long as it stayed within the Sri Lankan state. They demonized Sri Lankan society, particularly the majority Sinhalese, and made ludicrous claims about ethnic cleansing and genocide. The irony is that, in actual fact, it was the LTT itself that perpetrated such atrocities in its attempts to carve out an insular monoethnic state. It was the LTT